he basically needed a first place finish. It was first or nothing on event six for him to go to the games. I can't imagine that pressure. Just thinking about that right now kind of makes me want to vomit.
I had resigned myself after event five to saying that he wasn't going to go this year.
I had this sense of impending doom, and I think all of the training think tank coaches that were watching at that point were all like, man, this is like an impossible deficit. He has to win this event in order to qualify.
It's almost like everything he's done for the last how many months has led up to this one workout.
We knew that Travis had to win. We knew that he had to show up and do this killer performance, but we didn't know how bad other people had to do too.
He has to win the workout. There have to be certain guys that are in between him and the person that's in fifth place at the time.
It was just like as many thoughts, feelings, and emotions as I've ever experienced at one individual moment in time. Man, Travis, if nothing else, makes things exciting. And he has made my coaching experience pretty exciting. And I think all the fans of me and of him that know me, that get contact with me, I think he's made their fan experience exciting also. It's one thing to have somebody that you just know is gonna come home in the clutch and has no weaknesses and is gonna win every time. And they get posted up as, the god of the sport, but we all love underdogs. It's the narrative and, Rocky stories and the miracle hockey team. And, we love to hear about these people that are kind of everyday people that are capable of really amazing things. And that's kind of what Travis is to me. He's like a part of my family. He's like my little brother. He's the first elite athlete that I've been involved from the beginning with. He's helped grow my brand. And there's just a lot of emotion tied to that. And, at this point, we really do have a good rhythm. Like, I understand how he works. I understand how his body works. We understand what we have to work on. We understand kind of what his weaknesses are. We know what he's really good at. We know what he needs to get better as a competitor. We know kind of where he fits in at the sport. He knows that it's now his responsibility to take all the stuff that we've put into place and all the stuff that we've continued to work on. And it's his job now to show up at competition. And really, I'm a lot more hands off with him than I have been in the past, because it's like training is our thing together, and now competing is his thing. And preparation leading into regionals was great. Everything was going well, and we had to make a couple adjustments when the pec tear thing started happening, and we started accumulating volumes of dips. His pecs would get a little bit of tight, we'd back off, we'd go back into it, we'd back off, more accessory work. But really, things couldn't have gone any better with regards to how intense his mind was and how much work he had put in. So I go out, I travel to all the other regionals, and then the big show comes. And regional day one, Atlantic regional, I got a lot riding on it as a business. I got a lot riding on it emotionally. I know my athletes have a lot riding on it. And, Travis steps out on the floor, workout one, he does really well. I mean, he's 5'11", about 200 pounds. So probably typically not the type of body size profile that's crushing workout number one. He takes fourth. He was in a, pretty much a foot race until the last round to take third. I think Jacob and Noah kind of like ran away with that workout. We're a little bit too far away from his capacity at his leg length on those squats. But it's a really good start. Everyone knows Travis has traditionally been a pretty slow starter at competitions, and he kind of builds and escalates his energy as he goes. And so to go out and forth, we're like, all right, cool, things are good. So we know workout two is not going to go so great. I think it went not so great, but it went worse than I had anticipated. Went around his testing time, his second testing time, with a couple no reps, and I think he just was a little bit scared and hesitant, didn't want to pec tear, knew that it was a long weekend, and just kind of throttled back a little bit. And in that region, a high 340 time was 20th place, which is just like, that's just a deep workout, a deep field on that workout. So it is what it is. He's in the final heat, kind of did what he had to do there. So after day one, he finishes, he's in the top 10, he's in the final heat, which was our objective, right? Be in the top, you have to be in the mix in the top heat. And if you're not, you're gonna have to grind. And we know that from last year because Travis was in 18th after day one and had to grind back, and regionals was just a gut-wrenching experience. So being in the final heat after day one this year was just nice. Goes out in day two. We knew workout number three was going to be good for him. Does what he has to do, takes second place. So now he's got a 2, a 4, and a 20 on the board, which is, you know, that's pretty good. That's like, all right, he's bringing it. Then we go into workout number four. Travis is really good grip endurance, really good toes to bar, really good deadlifts. Handstand walks are very good, but his speed endurance of them could use work, and something we've been constantly working on trying to get him to the elite level. And I think all of the shoulder stress in the previous workouts just makes that a little bit of a challenge. So some of the transitional elements there were a little bit slower. I think he finished that workout in 8th, if I remember off the top of my head. And, you know, so it's, you know, I kind of thought that would be a top 3 workout or top 4 workout for him. And so there's, you know, there's like, okay, you didn't fuck up, but you also didn't hit a home run. So I'm kind of indifferent about it. I come off and, you know, I was a little bit fired up. And Travis is probably one of the only athletes that I let him know what I'm feeling. Normally, that's just my responsibility, and I don't go on and say, like, I'm fucking disappointed. But Travis knows how much I've invested into him, the same way that he's invested into his own training. I moved my business out here to help support him because he was my best athlete at the time. I go out on the floor with him. I stayed with him at regionals because his wife is pregnant and had to stay home and take care of their baby. And, you know, I care about his success a lot. So I sometimes have a hard time blurring that line of being coach and being a family member. And I came off and I said some harsh shit, like, that just wasn't fucking good enough. You can't be walking your transitions. And, you know, in hindsight, maybe I don't say that in the middle of a competition, but I get heated and I care about it. And he understood. And so we kind of had our little fucking conflict, and we moved past it, and then we sat down, we had dinner that night, he got some work done, and we really just kind of sat there in, there was a lot of silence that Saturday evening because both of us had been in the position where Travis didn't make it back to the games before. And man, it's just such a deflating experience when you put that much into it. And you know, afterwards, like, what did I do wrong? What did he do wrong? Like, there's nothing you can do about the feeling. It just fucking sucks. And we both knew that that was a possibility. We both didn't want that to happen. And so I'm doing everything in my power to keep it light. And he's doing everything in his power to work on all of his mental strategies to stay focused and know that he can do what he can do. And I'm trying to fire him up. And him and Noah have this, you know, rivalry as, you know, same coach. They've been in the same region. They've been fighting against one another since 2013 when they both made the games back then. Travis made it in 2013, and then they both made it in 14, and then Noah made it instead of Travis, or Noah made it in 15 without Travis, then they both made it in 16. So they've both been there 3 times. They're kind of like rivals. They're on the same team. So I'm trying to use that and tell Travis. I told him, I said, look, you know, if you don't make it, you're going to be Noah's training partner leading into the games. You're going to have to come up and help me prepare him, which he did not like to hear. But that fired him up and reminded him what's at stake emotionally. And so we sat down, we had dinner. We talked about it. We got a game plan in place for workout number 5. We had a game plan in place for if workout 5 didn't go well. And then we went out saying, like, okay, sub-8 is the goal. Your best training time was 8:50 or something. You blew up on this. Let's break it up a little bit earlier. He gets into the workout and, like, you can tell from Travis kind of wears his emotions on his sleeve. So he goes out there and you can see he's just like, he's tight, stiff, he's excited. And he gets this like laser-like focus in his eyes. And, you know, they kind of all have that in the final heat. So it's, you know, it's like a den of wolves going out to fight one another. And he goes out and, you know, he goes out, his reps look good, everything looks good, his speed of contraction looks good, and then you can just see it hits him and his pressing just goes. I mean, he gets over the rings, but he literally can't get out. He gets a couple no reps. He finishes in like 9:02, which was pretty close to his best training time, so it's not like he shit the bed, but I think the energy just like dropped. And there's nothing to say. We prepared for that moment. He goes from, I think he was in fourth place before that workout or third place before that workout, and he drops to seventh, and he's 26 points out. And now it's dealing with reality, and it's dealing with the fact that everything that we've done is now on the line for a workout that is painful. And the only way he is going to make his dream come true of making it back a fourth time and podiuming at the CrossFit Games is to win the workout. Now, you can go out and say, well, I'm just going to do my best and hope I get a little bit of help. Or you go out and say, I am going to make a statement and win this workout and do everything in my power to make it happen. And we have this alter ego that we've been developing. I know we took Travis's games mat last year, and one time he was out over the weekend, and we taped over it, and we taped Trevor over it, because the running joke is nobody knows who Travis is, and sometimes Travis doesn't show up, but when Travis gets mad, then he always shows up. And I started saying, I am in love with that athlete. That's the athlete that I want to coach, and I called him Trevor. So I went into the back, and there's really not that many words that you can say at that point. It's, you know, you gotta fucking win. Go get your headphones, bring Trevor out, and fucking win, and show people that there is a reason they should know who you are. And, you know, I think there's something that happens when people have been working together for so long that is, it's almost tangible. I think some of my athletes are sometimes confused by that. We've been through so much together as athlete and coach. We've been to the games multiple times. We've dealt with ups and downs and me getting pissed off and him building resentment and all of these things together, that our relationship now is so strong that some things can just be left unsaid. And at that point, I realized that I had no control. And I also realized that something shifted inside of me, that I had tremendous faith in his ability to do what I knew he was capable of doing on that workout. And there was really like no doubt in my mind that if he decided that he was going to win the workout, that nobody would beat him on that specific workout. And that thought both excited and terrified me. So I'm up in the stands and, you know, the previous heats are going, and I had two athletes that were in the earlier heats that their dreams of making the games weren't there, and I had a discussion with them that it was time for them to help me make a fucking statement, that even though my athletes, not all of them are going to make the CrossFit Games, that none of them are going to fucking give up. And I think that final workout is just an absolute fucking gut check. It's just pain at that point. And I think most people are only willing to push through pain if there's some sort of reward or their goal to be there. And I told my athletes, you need to end this regional on a good note. You might retire, you might never be back here again, and you don't want your final memory of a sport to be you just went soft on the last workout. You need to go out there and you need to absolutely give everything that you possibly can to this workout and try to get a win. Try to end it on a good note and try to make a statement about who you are and what your character reflects as an athlete. And my Kyle Bernier's in a low place finishing spot after the fifth workout. It's his first regionals experience. I don't think he knew what to expect. He didn't have good prep leading in because he had an elbow issue going on. And he went out there and absolutely just destroyed the workout. He had two no reps and took fourth. He potentially could have won the workout had those two no reps happened. So I'm going into this final event with like more and more, you know, pride. Like, oh my God, this is awesome. I can't believe they did that. Then Aaron Hanna does the same thing and comes out and he drops the hammer in spite of knowing that he's too far out to actually close the gap and qualify. He still goes out and crushes it. And it's just like, okay, I had some really, really good experiences. However, the second to last heat goes and then I'm waiting and the final heat's building and it's coming and all the females go and then, all right, they bring the final males out on the floor and it was just like as many thoughts, feelings, and emotions as I've ever experienced at one individual moment in time. And I couldn't even sit with my staff because I didn't want them to see me in such a state of excitement and vulnerability. And I didn't know how I would react if it didn't go well. I didn't know if I was gonna break out and cry if it went badly. I didn't know. And normally I feel relatively in control of my emotional state, but I absolutely felt like I had nothing to do with my own state of existence at that period of time. And I'm sitting in the stands and I'm going through the worst case scenario. Noah's in first by a long shot. This workout's not good for him. He's not going to be able to, he might fuck up and not make it. Travis is not going to qualify. All of the media that we did, we were, you know, I had a girl who took sixth, a girl who took ninth, a team that took sixth, and then my two, you know, a guy who's almost near the bottom, a guy who's in the middle of the pack, and then two guys that should have qualified that didn't qualify. And all these thoughts are like building my anxiety. And I'm sitting there and putting together all the strategy that I try to teach my athletes how to singular their focus and stay positive. And I'm like, okay, take a deep breath and remember that this is not about you. It's not about your business and nothing's gonna change whether or not you win or lose, and just fucking watch and cheer them on. And I think that set the stage for probably the greatest moment of my coaching career. And it was, fuck, I watched that moment over and over and over again on video afterwards, like 15 times, just trying to process what it was that I was feeling. And I just remember right before it started, my heart rate was at like 180 beats a minute. And I was like sitting in the stands with a couple of people that know me that were on a team that was competing. And I was just trying to stay quiet and trying to stay calm and not try to let any of that shit out, because I thought they would turn around and think that I was fucking crazy if I was screaming. And you hear stand by, and then they jump on and they start to get on the assault bike, and everybody goes out like a bat out of hell. Noah's like amongst one of the top people off of the assault bike, which I didn't expect, because even though we do assault bike work, it's not really his thing. And Travis is like sixth off the assault bike, and people are like two or three burpees in by the time he gets off. And I have a fucking brick in my stomach. I've never felt like so helplessly out of control. And I'm like, fucking go, Travis, come on. And Noah's in the mix against the elite, and I'm back and forth, Travis, Noah, where are they? Travis, Noah, okay. At some point in the middle of the burpee box jumps, I know, okay, Noah's all right, he's gonna qualify. And now all of my focus is diverted towards Travis. And Travis is working at a burpee speed that's faster than everybody else, and he's catching up, and I'm just building and building and building. And I'm like, come on, dude, come on, come on, come on, come on, push it, come on. He gets to the sandbag and he just fucking savaged the sandbag. Just up and over, walk, up and over, four down. Then, okay, he's in the lead, come on. And then it's just about finishing. And earlier in the event, Travis like came off the ring dips in event two, and he kind of jogged across the finish line, and everyone busted my balls about it. So in my head, I'm like, come on, dude, we've talked about this all year. Complete it, finish all the way through the line. Finishes his 10th sandbag, no refs, picked it up, crossed the line, he wins. And it was just like, okay. And I thought there would be like this tremendous moment of like, yes, but I didn't fucking know if he qualified. So I'm like, okay, he did everything that he could. Noah finishes second, and it's like, awesome. but I'm still in a state of uncertainty. And so I walk around to the back to the warm-up area. I know that they're just corralling the men and waiting for the scores. Caroline's back there, and I told her that I was going to watch the final heat and then come back there. She just had her dream ripped out from underneath her, and not like, you know, it's sports, and she didn't underperform. Like, she just got beat. She took sixth place. Brianna's back there because she was in the final heat. You know, there's a lot of emotions and sadness and all of that stuff, and my head is just ripped in a million different directions. I'm thinking, like, what the fuck do I say to them? I can't be present here because my thoughts are like, fuck, did he qualify? Because I know what this situation is here, but I don't know what's going on over there. I don't know if we qualified. I don't know where we're going to finish. And then I'm just sitting there, just waiting. And I'm fucking pacing back and forth. And they call out the names. And they call out, Noah. And then they call out Alex Smith. And then they call out Ben Smith. And then they say, you know, hey, this athlete moved from sixth to fourth. And Travis was in seventh before that, not sixth. So in my head, I'm like, oh, no, he didn't. Okay, so there's one more spot. And then they said Travis Mayer. And that moment was indescribable. I don't know if it was relief, happiness for him having made it happen. I don't know if it was, you know, all of the culmination of everything that we've done together as coach and athlete. And I just fucking teared up. It was emotional. And I think even talking about it right now, it's fucking emotional for me. It was a profoundly awesome experience. And also, you know, there was some sadness, and, you know, I want everyone's dreams to come true. I don't want to just highlight that this is Travis's moment or this is my moment. And then afterwards, like, you know, there the scream that I saw on camera of what Travis did when he found out it was him, the dude like never lets emotion out. We sit in my office and I sit here for 45 minutes getting him to tell me what's going on in his head, and to see just that true barbaric scream and happiness that came out for everything that he did up until that moment. And then probably the most happiness that I felt was right after that. I saw right before they cut to the CrossFit Passion cheering section for him, I see a hand come in, and it's Noah coming in and giving him a hug. And to know that my two athletes that are all over my media qualified and are going to the CrossFit Games together in their first year, and that Noah cared enough to congratulate him was just a really cool experience.
Yeah, I mean, the course of the day, event five, watching him go through that in that last heat where everybody else basically beat him in that workout. I think maybe there's one other guy that he beat there. He finished that 8:20 or so around his training time. But even then, I had resigned myself after event five to saying that he wasn't going to go this year. I was thinking about the situations, thinking about coming in here to work, having to, you know, do we talk about it? Do we not talk about it? How's he going to handle it? What's his training going to be like for the first month, first, second month, third month? Is he going to have the same fire that he did missing again, just like he did before? So I was worried for him, how he would handle it. I was worried for the business, how the business would handle it, because we had placed such high expectations on him. We basically put him out and say, hey, this guy's going to the games, watch this. Now he's not going to the games. That was my mindset. I was resigned to the fact that this guy's not going to make the games.
There were all kinds of emotions going into the last day for Travis. You know, getting to know him over the last couple of years, being up here, being a training partner of his at times. I usually can't keep up with him. He breaks me down too much. But, you know, all of the time spent and all of the time watching him work hard and all of the time watching him put in more time on movement and the other priorities that he has than anyone else and how hard he works makes you just love the guy and makes you kind of buy into what he's doing and makes you cheer for him more than anybody else. And then outside of that, just being a friend, you know, hanging out on the weekends or coming over and playing ping pong. I was extremely invested in his success in that way, outside of him just being in the brand. But the last day was stressful because I knew that the fifth workout may be bad for him. He had some issues with muscle ups leading into that week. And sure enough, you know, he finished, I think, 25th or something like that in the workout. And that really bumped him down. I think he finished, he was in seventh after that workout. And so now I'm thinking in my head, like, oh man, what could happen if he doesn't make it? Like, all of a sudden we're going back to the drawing board. It's going to be a summer of like just him being so upset, and what's Max going to be like? What is the brand going to look like after this? I was here 2 years ago when he didn't make it, and that whole summer was just like blah, right? Like there was no intensity in the gym because he was upset.
I've always had like people that I cheer for when they're competing, especially individuals, and this is so different in that I've never been nervous for an individual like I have watching Travis. Excited, but like nervous on the outcome because I know I'm around him so much and we all know how much he puts into this. And I hate to say that like the outcome would have changed what the next year looked like, but it 100% did. Like this outcome, whether or not he qualified, changes the next year drastically. You know, business, training, community in the gym, like it's just you have the route where, you know, is there a heartbeat in the summer when we're here training because we have someone that's, you know, on a mission that's got something that they've got to go do the next step, or is it quiet, you know, for the next 3 months, 5 months, however long till the season begins the next season? So just the uncertainty of knowing what that's going to be like, you know, the uncertainty of, you know, his business, like what does this mean to people that come in town and want to go to the gym where, you know, the CrossFit Games athlete trains at, like the people that come in to train with him, our clients, like it just, I hate to say any of it's dependent on that outcome, but it really is if you're looking at it in reality. I mean, just knowing that this is his job, like this guy puts everything into it, you know, he's got a wife and two kids, he makes money doing this, seeing that on the line where it's just, there's just no safety net, there's no guarantee, is just so nerve-wracking, you know, especially when it's like one of your friends, like you want them to succeed so bad.
You see the SkyTrain every single day for the past year, you know all the hard work that goes into it, and obviously there's a little bit more of like an emotional component than most of the other games competitors who like I have no actual connection to. So it was pretty like nerve-wracking seeing him going into the last event, and you're like, is he gonna pull it off? Is he gonna make it?
I remember being in the back in the warm-up area, and I was talking to Ben and Frank before they went out, and I glanced over and saw Travis, and he's got his headphones on, his head down, and he's stretching over on the rig, and he's got an expression on that I'd never really seen, and I kind of got this pit in my stomach. I was like, oh God, he's not, you know, the performance isn't going to happen here. He's not ready for this. He's in some sort of, he's in a funk right now. He knows it's already over. I think I misread the emotions that were on his face because I think what he had there was a determination. He was like gathering himself to perform in that last event. So I remember going out, you know, to watch the final event, and I had this sense of impending doom. And I think all of the training think tank coaches that were watching at that point were all like, man, this is like an impossible deficit. He has to win this event in order to qualify.
We're on the leaderboard looking at how event five went for the individuals. And we knew that Travis wasn't going to do the well in that one. He talked about it. I know he had a plan the night before, but Brandy told me, she said, you know, he didn't do that great in that one. It dropped him out quite a bit. He's in seventh by 20 something points. And I was just like, dang, you know, like, I don't see that happening anymore where you can make a jump like that again. I feel like the sport, people are just getting so good, but people have done it in the past, but I just for some reason had this thought in my head that no, like not anymore. Like you can only use that so many times, you know, like you only get that break so many times. And last year he made a big jump last minute at the end. So it's like almost like I felt like it was a tall order to ask for it again, you know?
Well, I mean, when you think about it, you have to trace this process back to when the games ended last year, right? And he started training for this coming year. And it's almost like everything he's done for the last how many months has led up to this one workout in this one scenario where he's in control in that if he wins, it helps him out a lot, but he's not completely in control because there are still so many other competitors and what they do matters in how he finishes. And I think that Travis has done such a good job over the last year of working on his mental game. You know, he's so talented as an athlete, but that only gets you so far. And if you don't have that like fire and that intensity and drive to win and do your best, you can only finish or do as well as your physical abilities let you. But that like extra gear and that extra push, it's Trevor. That all comes from him and inside here. And I think he's worked on that so hard the last year. And that last event is kind of like the culmination, and like that's what he needed to do.
So going into the last event, you know, I mean, of course we're all gathered up cheering for him, and he's at the very end, kind of far from us. And it's just in the Atlantic Regional, like the energy is unlike any region I've ever seen. Like the community is very tight knit. People are loud as shit. I was there 2 years ago when Easy qualified for the first time, and it was just, it freaking erupted. It's unlike I've ever seen in the sport in that region. And again, there was uncertainty going into like who's safe in this final event. So we knew that Travis had to win. We knew that he had to show up and do this killer performance, but we didn't know how bad other people had to do too. So it was just like, yell for him, hope he does, you know, the best he can in it and wins it. But that's still not even like a guarantee that anything good will happen out of it, just because he's so many points out.
Yeah, so we go into the last workout, and I know everything has to be right for him. He has to win the workout. There have to be certain guys that are in between him and the person that's in fifth place at the time.
And that was where I just thought there was no chance. You know, these other guys, they are top level athletes. They're not gonna fall off. This is out of his hands. He can do what he can, but even if he did the best of his ability and he got, you know, 2 minutes on that thing, it's not gonna matter. It's still out of his hands. So that was my mindset.
And there is so much pressure, like in our little section of the stands, we're all sitting there talking. I was actually talking to Kyle Ruth about, okay, this is what he needs to do, and this is where this person needs to be. Let's make sure that we're following each person, that he's in lane, you know, 8 or whatever it was, and he's in lane 4, so watch these two guys and make sure he beats them. And I mean, all kinds of stuff we're talking about.
They come out for that workout. He's got his game face on. Trevor's ready to go. He's got him all locked and loaded.
And then, you know, the horn blows,
you know, 3, 2, 1, go. He's on the bike. He's one of the last people off the bike. And I'm thinking like, damn, you know, like he quit, you know, he gave up.
I was just like, oh man, it's over. It was just too slow on the assault bike. He paced it too much.
But then part of me was like, no. This is, I've trained with Travis. I've seen him do like short 3-minute workouts. Like this dude is a freaking savage on those kinds of events. Like he is an absolute animal.
And so I'm thinking, all right, if he just picks it up on the burpee box jumps, he's gonna be okay.
He gets to the box, he's moving quick, and all of a sudden he starts pulling ahead.
He just started chipping away on those box jump overs, and then
he's like starting to pass one guy and then a second guy and then a third guy, and all of a sudden he's in second place. And when he gets to the sandbag and he grabs the sandbag, I'm saying if he's got something left, he's gonna win this workout. He's one of the best I've ever seen in a sandbag.
And at this point I'm like, oh shit, like he's gonna do something crazy.
And then all of a sudden he hit his first sandbag, turned right around, grabbed the next sandbag and threw it over his shoulder, and I was like, oh, he's actually got a shot.
And sure enough, he just does one, and then he does two, and then he gets three, and then four, and he's picking the bag up, going to 6, getting to 8. There's 2 left, and I don't even remember what happened. You know, everybody made fun of me after this, but I just got so intense in the stands. I'm screaming. I lost my voice for like 4 days after this, but I'm like, yeah, go Travis. I'm like yelling for him, not that he could hear me.
He's throwing this thing around like a toy. Like I haven't seen anyone move the sandbag like this, and he just doesn't stop.
And then like the momentum just built, the emotions built. And as Travis went, man, it was just, the pace that he held on the sandbags was almost superhuman. And I think that's what he was doing in the back. When I saw him, you know, focus with the headphones on, he was gathering himself and preparing himself for that monumental effort that he put out there. He wasn't thinking about how the whole weekend was over.
And he crosses the finish line first, and we are going apeshit, like absolutely apeshit.
But my eyes are on everybody else, the people that he's got to beat. It's a weird feeling in this sport to have to root against people. That's all I'll say about that. I don't have anybody that I root against because I don't like them as a person. I have people that I try and cheer for because I enjoy their interviews. I enjoy how they hold themselves. I enjoy whether they're authentic and genuine in how they treat themselves in social media. But when you've got somebody like Travis, who I call a close friend, who I'm invested in his results, for me, that's probably what it's going to take for me to cheer against somebody. And it's a weird aspect of this sport to be put into that situation, because it's not about what Travis does. It's about now what are the other guys going to do.
When he crossed the line holding the bag, I knew right away that he had won the workout. That was the fastest time. And all of us were giving each other hugs. We were high-fiving and, you know, gave my wife a kiss, and she's pumped for him because, you know, she's become a friend of his. And, you know, that was one of the best experiences I've ever had in CrossFit, watching a close friend and a training partner finish the way that he finished.
We got our phones out, we're looking at people still going, we're like, oh my God, this person has to finish here, he'll get this many points, and we're losing our mind. And I think after the whole workout finished, we saw who finished where, and we had this glimpse of hope that, damn, I think he made up the point spread. Like, I actually think he freaking did it.
I'm watching the other guys, I'm watching how it shakes out, I'm doing the math in my head. And when Travis crossed over, and then the other guys started coming over one at a time, it was just this feeling of, holy crap, he's gonna do it. Holy crap, he's gonna do it. There's another one, holy crap, he's gonna do it. And then it was, he did it.
That just goes to show how different, you know, the elite are, the way that they think versus the guys that are on the cusp. The guys that are on the cusp look at a 26-point deficit and they're like, my weekend's over. I'm not going to the games, it's over. The guys like Travis, they look at it and they're like, here's a challenge for me, I'm gonna go crush this.
You know, you talk about guys finishing strong, and man, that was execution for the ages right there. And he came out swinging and he won.
So after the dust settled, after everybody in that heat had finished their workout, the times were up on the board, I'm taking those times, I'm mapping them across the prior heats, and I'm doing the math in my head, just making sure, because I can't do that weight. I can't just sit there and have drama be handed to me on a platter. I've got to figure it out for myself. I did the math in my head and I realized that he, not only did he do what he had to do, the chips fell in his favor. People finished lower than they probably needed to or should have, and we knew that he was going back at that point. And that was walking around for 4 hours that day, trying to picture the summer and the fall and the winter of Travis not going back to the games. And then in that moment, it all gets lifted off your shoulders. That was a great feeling. That was a really good feeling.
He basically needed a first place finish. It was first or nothing on event six for him to go to the games. I can't imagine that pressure. Just thinking about that right now kind of makes me want to vomit. But yeah, man, that's it. Because sometimes that can overhype you and you go out too hot and like something can go wrong and it can all spiral out of control. Or you can do literally exactly what he did and just capitalize in the moment. He was able to pull it off, and that was really cool. I was excited. I couldn't tell during the workout what was happening. I was kind of doing my own thing. I was surprised with myself that I was able to take second. So I didn't even know that he had just beat me. But knowing that we were 1 and 2, I'm sure that was really cool for Max. And I was thinking, but it would be even cooler if he qualified. So when we were all sitting on the finish mats and they were calling out one by one who was going to the games, they start with first because it's, I guess, a little bit less, there's less guests to that. So they go first me, second Alec, third Ben, and then it came down to fourth and fifth. And I remember myself like pacing around, like my palms sweating, my heart racing, being more nervous about them calling whoever was in fourth and fifth than for when they called me. And when they did call Travis, I remember being pretty fired up and going over and giving him a hug. And just because I knew, number one, I know how much he wants it, and because I want it that same amount. And so I know that that's awesome. Number two, we are kind of teammates and more friendly, so I'd rather see him go than somebody else. And I know that that'll kind of give me somebody else to kind of lean on and talk to throughout the games week versus just doing that all by myself. And then number three, that would obviously make Max and the whole Training Think Tank community even more excited than if it were just me. So it all worked out, and hopefully kind of pans out the same way out in Madison.
Let me explain that I'm excited for Training Think Tank when this happens. I'm excited for Max because as much as work as Travis puts into this, Max is right there doing the same. Like, I know what it means to him when he has success shine through one of his athletes, because this guy truly like works harder than anyone I've ever met. Like, it makes me almost like self-conscious of how hard he works, because I'm like, why can't I do that? Like, I wish I was made of that. And it pushes me to a new level. So just seeing, you know, his labor come to fruition was It was really awesome.
That's the moments that we do this for. Like, that's what sports provide us. And I don't know if I didn't care, if I didn't do all the work, if I didn't, you know, invest everything that I have emotionally into these guys, if I would have been able to experience something like that. And I was messed up for like a whole week, but I don't think I've ever felt that level of gratitude for anything in my entire life.
I hate him. I hate him for putting us all through that every single Sunday for the last 3 years now. I resent his ability to put himself in that situation and then still dig himself out of that hole. He's an amazing athlete.
I forget the exact quote, but I think it's something like, it takes a village, and it's supposed to be in reference to raising a child. It takes a village of people to raise a child. I think high-level athletes are like that. People don't realize how much focus and just raw work goes into being an athlete, especially in this sport. It's not a sport where you can just do, you know, 2-hour session in a day. You're doing hours and hours and hours of technical work and hard work and mobility work and eating, and you're constantly at the edge of what your body and your emotions can take. And it's really, really, really important to have a support structure. And, you know, as a coach, I can provide an environment that supports him in training. I can give him training partners, I can give him massage therapy, I can give him nutrition to help him support his body. But the one thing that really can't be replaced is love. And it is kind of cliche to say that love is one of the most important ingredients in becoming great, but it's true.
And seeing it firsthand, what that support structure has done to help him grow into the man and the athlete that he is today, has only reinforced my understanding of how important the human bonds and the connection of support is to develop somebody's skill in anything.